All right, well, it's good to see you all here today. I would like to start our gathering in a good way by acknowledging that the University of Alberta is built upon the traditional lands of the Cree, Blackfoot, Métis, Nakota Sioux, Iroquois, Dene, Ojibwe, Soto, Anishinaabe, Inuit, and many other Indigenous peoples. By acknowledging and teaching about past and contemporary injustices, we are making an effort to help ensure that history does not repeat itself. It is only when we are accountable for the past and understand the present that we can move forward to a future of conciliation. I would also like to acknowledge and thank all of the Indigenous people on our campus who are working diligently to make meaningful change to the system for future generations. And finally, I want to acknowledge that many Indigenous peoples from all across Turtle Island now live and study in Edmonton and at the University of Alberta. We need to value their diversity of cultural worldviews, their resiliency, and their many contributions. All right, well, it's my honor and privilege to welcome you all, whether you are attending in person or online, to this opening event for the History, Classics, and Religion Graduate Students Association's annual conference on the theme of societies in crisis, reactions, resilience, and resolutions. Just a wonderful contemporary theme and topic for this conference. My name is Ryan Dunch. I'm the chair of the Department of History, Classics, and Religion at the University of Alberta, a job that I've had for a while now and have one more year to go. I've been at the university since 1998. I remind people at every opportunity that there's one more year, you need a new chair. But the University of Alberta is one of Canada's leading comprehensive research universities with over 40,000 students and 500 graduate programs, as well as 200 plus undergraduate degrees. And our department dates back to the beginnings of the University of Alberta in 1908, when the departments of history and classics were both among the founding departments in the university. Today, our department is home to 7 undergraduate degrees, 7 graduate degree programs, in the separate disciplines of classics, history, and religious studies, as well as in interdisciplinary degree programs that link across those disciplines. We have many areas of research strength among our faculty members and our graduate students, including most relevantly, I won't try to list them all, but most relevantly for today's event, we have research strengths in Ukrainian history and Ukrainian studies and in religious studies and the history of religion, which is an area of strength in classics and in history, as well as most obviously in religious studies. This conference, the HCRGSA Graduate Student Conference, is an annual event that is intended to showcase research undertaken by the around 75 graduate students in our department, ranging across the disciplines of history, classics, including classical archaeology, and religious studies. It also features the research of graduate students from other disciplines at the University of Alberta and from other institutions. I think I meant to welcome specifically people who are observing online today's event. I see there are 48 participants online, in addition to probably 40 in the room. So that's great to see. The conference today and over the next few days is generously supported by the Faculty of Arts Conference Fund, by the Belzberg Jewish Studies Endowment, and the Jewish Federation of Edmonton, by the Lutsky Family Foundation, and by the Department of History, Classics, and Religion itself. Lastly, it's my pleasure to introduce our distinguished colleague, Dr. John Paul Himka, who is Professor Emeritus of History. Dr. Himka has an international reputation for his groundbreaking scholarship on the history of nationalism in Central and Eastern Europe and on the history of the Holocaust during World War II in Ukraine and in its surrounding regions. And John Paul will introduce our guest speaker today. So, thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, professors and students, Jews and Ukrainians, fellow Edmontonians, I am very pleased to have been invited to introduce our very distinguished speaker, Professor Henry Abramson of Touro University in Brooklyn. Touro is a private university established in 1970 for the higher education of the Jewish community. Dr. Abramson has been serving as the Dean of Arts and Sciences at Touro since 2015. Although based in the United States for over two decades now, Dr. Abramson is a fellow Canadian. He was born in 1963 in a small town then known as Ansonville in Ontario. Later, the former Ansonville was incorporated into Iroquois Falls, but it can still be found on Google Maps. Ansonville is in the far north of Ontario, 450 miles north of Toronto. This is a locality that experienced the coldest temperature ever recorded for Ontario. In January 1935, the mercury here dropped to minus 70 degrees. The young Henry grew up, and it's hard to believe that it's a young Henry. There once was a young Henry. The young Henry grew up in this frosty land where people traveled by snowmobile and kids occupied themselves with cross-country skiing and sledding. Henry was the sole Jewish child in this small town. He had to learn to fight to defend himself against some anti-Semitic bullies. His parents took care of his Jewish education. Since Ansonville was so poor in Jewish educational resources, his parents sent him to Toronto when he was 10. His mother lived with him, and several evenings a week, he would attend a Jewish school where he learned Hebrew. He received his education in Toronto, university education in Toronto, earning a BA, MA, and PhD there. He wrote his doctoral dissertation under the supervision of a leading historian of Ukraine, Professor Paul R. Magucci. It was while he was a graduate student at U of T that I first took notice of a bright young scholar who was working on a key topic in the history of Ukrainian-Jewish relations. As I see it, he was undertaking a major project that would lay firm foundations for much of his later work and that brought him to prominence among historians of East Central European Jewry. It was an examination of Ukrainian-Jewish relations during the turbulence and violence of the Ukrainian Revolution of 1917-20. This was a rich and controversial theme. During the revolution, the short-lived Ukrainian government implemented an unprecedented program of equal rights and cultural autonomy for the Jewish population, complete with a Ministry for Jewish Affairs and official status for the Yiddish language. But when the government began to lose control over its territory and population and to transform into a mobile armed camp, troops loyal to it perpetrated savage pogroms against the Jews, killing tens of thousands of them. The assessment of the period has been radically different in the historical memories of Ukrainians on the one hand and Jews on the other. No one had been able to sort it all out, and the historiography was full of acrimony. Henry worked hard here and brought more sense to the topic than had ever been in evidence previously. He had the distinct advantage of having learned to read in Ukrainian, Russian, Yiddish, and Hebrew. The initial announcement of the results of his research was in the premier journal of the Russian and East European field, Slavic Review. He was still a graduate student when he published there. In 1995, he completed a doctoral dissertation on this subject. He did further research and reworked the dissertation into a book, A Prayer for the Government, published in 1999 by the Ukrainian Research Institute and Center for Jewish Studies at Harvard University. It received enthusiastic reviews and is still frequently cited and sometimes debated. I myself have cited it numerous times since it appeared. Working on that project led him to reflect more generally on the interaction of Ukrainians and Jews. And he wrote an article of great sensitivity and intelligence on this subject, truly a seminal text, The Scattering of Amalek. It destroys the myth of Ukrainian anti-Semitism as something inveterate or essentialist, and roots it instead in socioeconomic and political relations. He was still a graduate student when he wrote that too. What he learned from the Revolution Project has served him in good stead as he worked more and more on the central event of 20th century Jewish history, the Holocaust. In fact, one can see the work on the pogroms of the revolutionary era as a preparation for studying what happened just a few decades later. His article on the Demidenko affair, for example, Life Imitates Art, Limit Imitates Life, shows the influence of his earlier work as he reflects on Ukrainian collaboration with the Nazis in the murder of Jews and on the motivations of the participants. Quite a different kettle of fish is his later work on Rabbi Kolonimos Kalmish Shapiro. Shapiro was a Hasidic rabbi in the Warsaw Ghetto during the Nazi occupation of Poland. He delivered a series of weekly sermons to his congregation. After the war, the manuscript of his sermons was found amid the rubble of Poland's capital and was published in Israel under the name Esh Kodesh. Henry's scholarly explorations of the Holocaust from the vantage point of a Jewish holy man struck early readers, such as myself, as fresh and fascinating. I do not think that many scholars have the patience to mull over what the rabbi was saying the way Henry did. Nor do I think that many others would be able to explain the rabbi's points so clearly. In 2017, Dr. Abramson devoted a whole book to the topic, Torah from the Year of Wrath. Already in the 1990s, Henry exhibited an interest which would grow over time in visual images. I think this first came to the surface when he wrote his article, This is the Way It Was, on anti-Jewish cartoons in the Ukrainian newspaper published under the German occupation, Lviwski Vistu. His book, A Prayer for the Government, is lavishly illustrated. He later became involved in a documentary about wooden synagogues. This was The Lost Jewish Synagogues of Eastern Europe, directed by Carl Hirsch and released in 1999. He also became deeply involved in studying images of Jews in the Middle Ages. He produced an excellent little piece on the depiction of Jewish women in 1996, A Ready Hatred. While working in Florida Atlantic University in Boca Raton, he curated an exhibition entitled The Art of Hatred, Images of Intolerance in Florida Culture. Catalog to this exhibition was published as a book under the same title in 2001. Dr. Abramson has had fellowships and visiting professorships in rather prominent academic centers, the Hebrew University in Jerusalem, Cornell University, Harvard, and Oxford. He's been based longer at two universities. He was at Florida Atlantic University from 2002 to 2006. Then he joined the faculty of Touro College South, which was based in Miami. And in 2015, he moved to the main Brooklyn campus. He has produced a series of lectures online about Jewish history. It has had over 5 million views. He is presently working on a 3-volume history of the Jewish people. This evening, Professor Abramson will be speaking on 1,000 years of Jewish life in Ukraine. Prepare to be spellbound.
Well, I was spellbound during that introduction, I have to say. Professor Himka, I'm very grateful for that encomium that
We're recording that, right, Mr. Mo? Okay, so I'll play it back for my mother. She will love it. But I'm deeply grateful. And since you lavish so much time on my history, I should mention to the audience here that, thank God, when I was a graduate student, I did meet with a lot of success. Things fell into place in a very nice way. Things fell apart in a very useful way, I guess. The former Soviet Union was falling apart right about that time. And I usually met with positive critiques from my readers. But the one reader that floored me, that really took me down several pegs with an honest and useful critique, was none other than Professor Himka. I'm not sure whether you read the Slavic Review article, or maybe it was the dissertation, but he delivered just a two-line critique about my premises in going into this particular research, which demonstrated to me that I had really only looked at about 10% of the problem, and that 90% of it, like an iceberg, was under the surface, and that I had to really rework things if I were to do this right. So I'm deeply grateful to you. We can talk about it later if you want to remember the specifics, but it was the most useful piece of criticism I think I've received in my scholarly career from someone who was not my wife. So I think I'd like to begin, first of all, by acknowledging the very gracious host of this evening. I'm very grateful to the sponsors, especially to the graduate students who organized this. Mr. Parkilia and Ms. Schmaltz invited me, and I have to say that letter that you wrote, Ms. Schmaltz, did you write that letter? It was a beautiful letter. I was like, you had me at the first paragraph. I'm coming to Alberta because I felt it's such a great thing when students appreciate you. You know, it's one thing when peers do, but when students appreciate you, that's the best. I'm very grateful to Professor Coleman, who introduced me to some brilliant graduate students doing some excellent work. They are here in the audience today, Mr. Patterson and Ms. Kupinska. They have promised not to ask any hard questions. And I'm really grateful for the experiences I've had so far. And since this is a multi-ethnic audience, I'd like to begin by saying to everyone, Erev Tov, Dobry Vecher, good evening, A. Hopefully that covers everyone. Okay, but I really would like to begin my talk tonight with a small joke that it comes from the Jewish cultural canon. And I'm sure that many of you in the room will understand the references, but I hope that they will be sufficiently transparent that even if you don't come from this liturgical tradition, you will nevertheless understand the point of the joke. It goes like this. There's this out of work Jewish actor. He's living in Los Angeles. He's waiting for his big break. And meanwhile, he's waiting tables. And, you know, this goes on for a year, 2 years, and he's beginning to lose hope. He's beginning to abandon the idea that he'll ever be on the silver screen. And one day he's reading one of the trade papers and he sees that they're looking for a gorilla impersonator. And he says, oh my gosh, if I really sunk this low, but he just wants to act. So he decides to go out for the audition. It turns out that the Los Angeles Jew, excuse me, that's what Freudian said, the Los Angeles Zoo, the Los Angeles Zoo has lost its last primate. And until they get another one from Africa, they need an impersonator. So he wows them in the audition. He gets the part. And every day he finds himself strangely gratified by the experience. He puts on the gorilla suit. He gets into the enclosure. He beats his chest. The children squeal with delight. The parents are so happy. They throw peanuts at him. And he's finding new ways of expressing himself using his instrument in the most full way possible. And he's really finding fulfillment in his life. One day, he's, you know, really into his role. He trained in Stanislavski method and so on. He's really getting into his role, and he's swinging with a little bit more violence than usual from a vine to a vine, and he swings out of his enclosure and lands into the lion's den next door. Looks up into the face of this ferocious feline, and he knows his life is about to end. So, you know, it's been a long time since he went to Hebrew school, but he remembers that if a Jew knows that they are about to expire, the very last thing on their lips should be a pronouncement of the unification of God's name, their very last statement in the world. And so he covers his eyes with his right hand and he says, Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. He looks up and the lion says, Baruch Shem Kavod Malchus. And then the giraffe says, Shah, you'll get us all fired. Thank you very much for laughing. So the point of this story, which I think is a very sophisticated joke in many ways, points to the fact that identity is a very malleable thing. Identity is something that, as my teacher, Professor Magachi, used to teach, often involves a hierarchy of multiple loyalties. You know, we can have loyalties to our Edmontonian or our Ansonvillian roots, our Canadian roots, our religious tribe, our political tribe, our linguistic tribe. We can go on. And we sort of work with these things to shape for ourselves an identity. And what I would like to propose to you today, which I have learned from my meeting with Ms. Kupinska earlier today, this is not such a radical new idea, but we are looking at a very unique era in Ukrainian Jewish history in which a new Ukrainian Jewish identity is being forged. And I'd like to demonstrate that as we race through a millennium of I don't want to say necessarily coexistence, but Jews living side by side with Ukrainians in the space of about 60 minutes. I will speak very fast. Let's start with this image that you see behind me. This is a rather remarkable image. Let's place it in situ. It is a Holocaust memorial that is found on the outside of a synagogue in Lutsk, Ukraine, just to give you a sense of where Lutsk is. Well, I think we have to, if I click the mouse on here, you know what they say PhD stands for? Push here, dummy. So here's a map. You can see a little dot there where Lutsk is. It's sort of in northwestern Ukraine. Here's Kyiv marked here. And here's how it looks on the side of the building. This is a 17th century structure. It's what's called the traditional fortress style of synagogue architecture. Not coincidental that this occurs during the era of peasant revolts, the Khmelnytsky uprising, that synagogues were built much like this. I spoke at the Queen's Jewish Center just last week and it looked exactly like this, actually. And you can see it sitting there on the wall of the synagogue, a Holocaust memorial. Now, let's look a little bit more closely, though. Let's see how it's changed in the just a couple of years between those two pictures. First of all, you can see that the stucco work has begun to decline. This is taken, by the way, this picture is 2011, so it's long before the current conflict. But you can see that the synagogue has begun to decline and no one is apparently taking care of it. And you can see here, there's kind of an interesting sort of soft vandalism, possibly. Someone has applied two stickers, one above the other, to the memorial. But then someone else apparently has come and has removed those stickers, or at least attempted to remove it. So that gives us a little bit of a temperature read about how people feel about this memorial or what it might mean. There's text in two languages. You can hear on the right, the text is in Ukrainian, not in Russian, which speaks to a dramatic shift in language for Jews in Ukraine that occurred since independence in 1991. And on the left, perhaps not quite as surprising, text in Hebrew, not Yiddish. Yiddish, for those of you who are less familiar with Jewish languages, Yiddish is basically medieval German with phlegm. With phlegm. No, I dropped it again, but it didn't work. Okay, so it's basically medieval German with written in Yiddish Hebrew characters. A lot of a mixture of Romance languages and Slavic languages as well. And it was the overwhelming vernacular of Jews up until the Soviet Union came into existence. And then there was a rapid shift from Yiddish first language usage to Russian. But there were very, very few Jews who spoke Ukrainian as a first language, really until the end of the 20th century. And that process has accelerated dramatically, far faster than I had thought it would have occurred. Now, those things are all, I think, kind of interesting. But the most dramatic element of this, something that I'm sure students of Ukrainian history will have recognized immediately in this, but when I speak to Jewish audiences, they're oblivious. What the shape of the figure there, which appears to be someone
beseeching God, hands up raised in prayer, which is obviously evocative of the praying for mercy in the context of the Holocaust. How would Ukrainian Jews see that? Anyone want to offer an opinion? Please. Is it Trezov? Exactly. Thank you, Professor Coleman. Normally, if this was undergraduate, I would offer you a scholarship at Toronto University. But, for anyone living in Ukraine, it's the Trezov, the traditional trident of St. Volodymyr, associated with the Ukrainian national symbol, it's embedded directly within this very holy artifact of a Holocaust memorial, which is fascinating, especially because if you speak to Jews in the diaspora, Jews will frequently associate Ukrainians with collaboration with the Nazis. The opposite of the idea of embedding a Ukrainian national symbol, which also has strong Christian overtones because St. Volodymyr was the first Christian leader of the Kievan Rus, it's fascinating that it would be baked right into the image. And I think this points to the overall malleability of identity that we see in so many ways. This is an article, for example, that just appeared in a very important Jewish newspaper, The Forward, written by Michael Gold, who is the editor of, I think it's called Hadashot. It's a paper in Kiev. And you can see from the title, the birth of Ukrainian Jewish identity is happening right now. I'm hard pressed to disagree. Let us though explore this in greater detail, and I'll take you through this lightning fast review of Ukrainian Jewish history. We'll see how the questions go in the end. This is how most Jews think of Ukraine, or at least used to think of Ukraine before 1991, to be sure. This is the Pale of Settlement, which is the region that Jews were allowed to live in under Tsarist rule. Jews had been forbidden to enter into Muscovite territory since the late 15th century. And when Catherine II conquered much of this region in the partitions of the late 18th century, she found herself suddenly in charge of the largest single concentration of Jews in the world. So Jews in their geographic cultural boundaries don't necessarily identify Ukraine as a distinct entity, but they will kind of roughly speak of overlapping territories. Here is, by the way, where Ukraine is. For those of you who are less familiar with this map, this is a kind of a very rough bubble, but that's more or less roughly how Jews would think of Ukraine. It's only towards the western part of the Dnipro River, the so-called right bank, and extending generously into Austro-Hungarian regions and even into Polish and Belarusian regions. This is an area where Jews live side by side with Ukrainians for well over 1,000 years. And there were certain moments of unusual cooperation. As Professor Himka mentioned in the context of my research, this is a bill from 1918, 100 karbovanets. And during this very, very brief kind of honeymoon between Jews and Ukrainians in the gap between the fall of the Russian Empire and the rise of the Soviet regions, you see that the official languages of the country included on the top left, Russian, on the top right, Polish, and directly under the number 100, the phrase in Yiddish, 100 karbovances, 100 karbovances. Rather remarkable that Yiddish was actually recognized as an official language of Ukraine, albeit very briefly and very tenuously. And if you go into the archives, you see how difficult it was for them to actually manage this. But it shows a tremendous degree of sensitivity for this Jewish population, largely urban and so on. And we see many examples of this. Here is a stamp from the year 2011 that commemorates 70 years since the tragedy of Babin Yar, which of course is one of the greatest short-term massacres of Jews in the history of the Holocaust, which occurred in the city of Kiev. It is a shared place of memory because, of course, after the first 3 days, it was used by the Nazis to massacre many, many more Ukrainians, about 60,000 Ukrainians, but about 33,000 Jews lost their lives within the first few days. Nevertheless, even though it is a shared heritage of suffering, the image clearly has a Jewish symbol, the menorah, pointing out the specifically Jewish aspect of this tragedy. And at the same time, while you have these unusual moments and artistic expressions of solidarity, you also have some images which are much more difficult for most Jews to handle, such as, for example, the valorization of individuals like Stepan Bandera, who was noted for his closer relations with the Nazis in their attempt to drive out the Soviets. We spoke earlier today about the, there is a kind of a bizarre group of Jews who, in their opposition to Russia, have taken the ironic term Jidu Banderivtsi or something like that, Jewish Banderites, which is like one of the most weird oxymorons I've ever heard of, but maybe we'll get into that in greater detail. So in other words, this is a stamp of with someone's face on it that would be deeply offensive to many Jews. So how do these two things sort of coexist, and especially how do they create this unique identity? So let me begin at the beginning by letting you know how Jews came to Ukraine in the first place. This is actually a fascinating map illustrating one of the tools that historians are going to have to master. I'm afraid to tell that most of us at our age, where it's too late for us already, but you graduate students still have a chance. This is the genetic map. This traces the population of Jews moving through Europe based on the analysis of geneticists. And they have determined, for example, that the roots of Ashkenazic Jewry, basically from northern Germany, the Rhineland region, come from ancient origins in the land of Israel, specifically two major expulsions of Jews after the first and second Roman Jewish War in the first and second centuries. Many of them were taken, as Josephus, the ancient historian, describes, to Rome, to the slave markets there. After some time, this large group of people, perhaps as many as 100,000, a very large number, particularly for ancient times, ultimately were able to gain mobility. And in one of these remarkable things that geneticists can do, around the year 850, a very small group of them, a so-called founder event that included four women from northern Italy, made their way up to the Rhineland region. The geneticists who prepared this research, Dohar Behar, actually calculated that 46% of all Jews who claim to be Levites, Ashkenazi Levites, the particular tribal designation, descend from these four women, who I believe were named Sarah or Rebecca, Rachel, and Leah. Now, I made that up. I wasn't sure if it would work, but at any rate, that's where the Ashkenazim basically come from. There are other routes of migration and so on, but the part that concerns us is that they make their way in the 9th and 10th century to northern Germany, and then from the 13th and 17th century, there's a major migration eastward, as you see in this map here. The Ashkenazi Jewish community are both driven out of Germany by a rise in anti-Semitism, evinced by the rise of beliefs like the blood libel, a host desecration, and of course the Black Death of the 14th century. And at the same time, the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, which dominates much of Ukraine at this time, has a dearth of individuals who are literate and numerate and able to create an economy in the region. And so Jews are brought in, they're given a Magdeburg Recht, which is a kind of medieval set of privileges which communities can set up. It's a very appealing thing. They're able to set up essentially gated communities, kind of like Boca Raton, if you're familiar with that place. And they make their way to the region of Ukraine. It's also worth noting, by the way, that there's another significant Jewish population, although a very mysterious one, called the Khazar Empire, that has its capital at Itil, north of the Caspian Sea. Very, very mysterious people. Besides the historic legends of earliest settlement in the Krim, which is quite possible, given that Jews were frequently following Greek traders and Roman legionnaires to the region, but the Khazars feature very prominently in a lot of the earliest historical records we have of the period. The conversion of Saint Volodymyr, for example, mirrors essentially a story of the conversion of the Khazar king, but many historians dispute the validity of the entire episode, and there's precious little evidence that there was much of a Jewish Khazar kingdom. There have been some fascinating archaeological studies done. Some of them demonstrate that the Khazars tended to use home architecture, very similar to that used in the land of Israel in the ancient period. The five-room house is mirrored here, but that's disputed by many archaeologists, although there have been some very recent discoveries that suggest that Jews may have actually made their way to this territory. That was a long buildup for this one visual joke. But seriously, when we get to the Khazars, I can't help it. There are some really tempting pieces of data besides the somewhat fanciful descriptions that we have in the Povest Romanyeklet and so on. The Geniza archive discovered just south of Cairo, which is a massive treasure trove of medieval documents, hundreds of thousands of fragments of what was called sacred trash that was preserved by the Jews of Pustat. They found this document, which is a very demonstrably Jewish document. It's written in Hebrew, which is basically a letter of introduction. In modern Hebrew, it would be called a petek, that indicates that the bearer of this note has fallen on hard times and he's reaching out to co-religionists for financial support. Quite literally, these are used to our own day. People will knock on my door and will present a petek very much like this, albeit laminated. They didn't laminate back then, but seems to have held up pretty good. What's fascinating is that at the very bottom, this letter, which purports to originate in Kiev in the 12th century, is signed by an official in Turkic runes, which suggests that there were, in fact, some Khazarian Jews living in Kiev, many of them with a level of status that they could sign these communal documents testifying to the bona fides of the bearer. But there's no question that when we look at the Jews of Ukraine through genetics, certainly through linguistics, and through the written records that we have, they're overwhelmingly descended from those Ashkenazic Jews from the Rhineland and not coming from Khazarian origins. Now, what were Jews doing in this economy? This gets to some of the more complex and difficult aspects of Jewish life in Ukraine. They were brought in primarily to fill a niche in the economy, which is something that historically Jews have excelled in, long experienced with engaging in middleman economic roles. They found a position between the great landlords of Ukrainian territories, the Polish landlords who held these massive farms called latifundia. And as the traditional historiography goes, the Polish landlords were wroth to go down to Ukraine and actually manage these huge sprawling territories in order to gain their economic benefit. So they would hire Jews to go there and they would engage in what's sometimes called tax farming. The Polish landlord could say, for example, to the Jewish community, because these things were generally structured in an almost feudal manner, they could say to the Jewish community and their representatives, okay, we believe that you can collect 10,000 zloty from our latifundia this year. So I'll see you next year this time and you'll pay me for that. And you are authorized to go collect taxes in order to bring it to me. Now the Jews could then go back and had tremendous freedom, which was supported by the Polish noblemen who literally owned the entire town, the mills, the bridges, the presses, even the churches. And the Jews would then collect taxes on a variety of things. They could collect tax on produce, obviously, but they could also charge tolls for bridges. They could charge for hunting in the Lord's forest or fishing in the Lord's ponds. Basically, whatever they came up with, that would be a legitimate way to tax the population. Whatever profits they were able to earn was the delta between what they had to give the Lord and what they could collect for themselves. So if they had to come up with 10,000, they would try to collect from the Ukrainian peasants, let's say 12,000, and that 2,000 would be the backbone of the economy for this Jewish settlement. And the other 10 would go to the Lord. In some notorious cases, not too many which have been identified historically, but nevertheless, they loom very large in the Ukrainian imagination, as expressed in Ukrainian folk songs of the era. Jews even had the right to control access to the churches for baptisms. So you can imagine the insult if you had to baptize your child and you had to pay the Jew to get the keys to enter the church. So this was not seen very popularly by the larger population. One last detail, Jews were also given the right of propinatia, which means the ability, sole monopoly, to produce, to distill, and to sell alcohol, creating the ever-present kretschma, which is like a little Jewish inn that people would go to drink. And so you put these things together with one last item, lending money on interest, which is something that the church had allowed the Jews a monopoly of really since the 10th century. So you can immediately imagine, as in this picture here, which is kind of like a more happy depiction of it, you can imagine Ukrainians and all their finery coming to the Kretschma, where they enjoy some Jewish klezmer music, and the Jewish innkeeper is there, pouring them a drink. Maybe they're paying for it on credit against the harvest season. And that credit, of course, will create a tab that accrues interest. And at the end of the season, they find they've got a very large bill to pay. The huge flaw in this exploitative system was the fact that the nobleman could come back the next year and say, oh my gosh, wow, you're here right on time. Here's my 10,000. This is great. I must have lowballed it. So how about next year you go back and you collect for me 12,000? Because obviously you did it so easily. And that means that the Jews would have to go back and would have to raise 14,000 in order to maintain the same standard as the previous year. And this would spiral out of control, it would ratchet out of control to the point where there was a popular uprising. The most significant of those popular uprising is, of course, the Khmelnytsky revolution or rebellion of the middle of the 17th century, which was devastating for the Jewish communities of the region. Khmelnytsky is a huge heroic figure in the Ukrainian mind, primarily because he managed to lead a group of peasants who were essentially runaways from their land, and he united them. They were, they were famously quite fractious before he came to power. And he united them in a military strike on three groups of enemies: on the Poles themselves, their landlords, on Ukrainian Catholics who had betrayed their Orthodox roots, as the Kozaki saw it, to join the hated Catholics to the West, seeing that as an act of Polonization. And of course, the Jews who were the leaseholders, the Jews who were the arrendators who collected the money from them. Now, if you remember back in the 1990s, there were a huge series of riots in South Central Los Angeles, which were largely an expression of African-American anger against the white establishment. And these riots went on for days and fires everywhere out of control. But in reality, the population that was hurt the most was not the white establishment, who were largely able to collect insurance payments on whatever properties they owned in South Central, but it was the Korean shopkeepers who lived in that region, who actually opened and operated the bodegas there, and they were the hardest hit. Even though they were not part of the white establishment, they were definitely seen as alien and seen as a demonstration of white power, and so they suffered the worst. It's a very similar structural relationship to the way the Jews occupied that middleman position in Ukrainian territory at this time. And so Khmelnytsky's rebellion was overwhelming, and for Jews, it was so powerful that it actually was enshrined in the liturgy. And once a year, Jews will gather, they'll fast for the entire day, and they will recite liturgical poems that reference the horrible decree of Tachpatat, the decree of 1648-49, lives on indelibly in Jewish memory. That's why one of the aspects that's challenging to this idea of a new Ukrainian Jewish identity is that for Ukrainians, Khmelnytsky remains definitely a national hero. I mean, he rose up against the foreign oppressors, he drove them out of the land, created, a Ukrainian independence. He is like a George Washington in many ways. And he is seen here on a banknote from Ukraine. But for Jews, Khmelnytsky remains like, he's in the same family of people like Stalin and Hitler. So it's very hard for Jews to see Khmelnytsky, especially diaspora Jews like myself, without feeling a certain amount of trepidation. One of the things that we talked about today in our discussion was the process of lustration, which is associated especially with Václav Havel's Czechoslovakia, but we also see it in post Saddam Hussein Iraq and other places where countries who endure difficult periods of national stress have to go back and kind of clean up or polish, that's what the term lustration really means, their histories to try and work through some of these difficult issues. The United States of America, the country where I live in, has done a tremendous job of this with the Civil War in particular. We're all totally cool with like statues of Confederate war heroes. We even bring the Confederate flag into the Capitol on occasion. Whenever we have an insurrection, it's like, that's what you got to do. So, so this is a, one of those issues that I think Ukrainians will have to work through. And it's not just people like Khmelnytsky. It's also people like Bandera. And the Jews will also have to work through their lustration, trying to understand their role in this exploitative economic arrangement as well. But to move through our race through 1,000 years of Ukrainian Jewish history, Khmelnytsky's spirit, I see as one of those key elements of the Ukrainian psyche, the Ukrainian national, you know, the civic myth of when people believe what is it that makes Ukrainians Ukrainian, they'll point to things like this devil may care attitude that is associated with Kozake. You see it here in this stamp where the boat in the background, of course, was the once mighty Moskva. And here's the Ukrainian soldier on Snake Island, letting the soldiers there know what he thinks of that boat. This is very much kind of like a Khmelnytsky move. And the fact that they would put it on a stamp is also a kind of a Khmelnytsky illustration. So what characterizes much of this medieval period is really a triangular relationship. This is an image, the guy on the left there is wearing a suit, which was actually very fashionable in the late 1980s, believe it or not. I think I wore something like that at my bar mitzvah, not so much earlier. And I'm showing this here specifically because I want to talk about the arch, but also I have to take a moment to specifically thank the University of Edmonton and Kios for their support. My own archival research in Kyiv was in two big bursts. One was before the fall of the Soviet Union, when things were just beginning to open up, and a group of scholars with Ukrainian inclinations invited a group of graduate students to come to Kyiv and to do research. And it was still under Gorbachev. We were still, you know, very closely supervised and watched, and they put us in a kind of a KGB style spa where they could keep their eyes on us, and they would put us on buses, bring us in and so on. And I got to see some of the archival materials, but I was not allowed into the archives of the KPSS, the Communist Party archives. It was a way too high level for me at the time. And I came back to Canada, and the Soviet Union fell apart shortly thereafter. And I got a call within weeks of its collapse saying, come on back. We've cleared everything. You can get into the archives right now. And of course, I was a graduate student. We had no money. So I fished around, and Keyus immediately stepped up to the plate and offered me the funds necessary to fly out there and to get into the archives, which was an absolutely amazing experience. And it really made my dissertation. It was a complete game changer for what I was able to find there. The chaos was tremendously much better organized than the Academia Nauk. They had apparently had set up things in Kyiv that I was going to get an apartment. They would set me up and things like that. When I got to Boryspil, there was no one there, just the mafia. And I had a big wad of Canadian dollars, and I didn't know what to do. I didn't know anyone personally there because I was, you know, shunted around the first time. But I did remember that I did meet one elderly Jewish man who the Canadian Jewish Congress asked me to bring him some of a specific type of medicine that he needed and he couldn't afford. So I was able to take one day trip on my first time to Kyiv and deliver this medicine to him. And I vaguely remembered sort of what his building looked like. It was a Khrushchev, you know, one of those five-story walk-ups. And I had a taxi driver take me around until I thought it might be that one. I walked up. I thought it was on the top floor. I knocked on the door, and thank God they were there. So the Academia Nauk fell apart, but I was able to spend a few months living with the Ukrainian family, Ukrainian Jewish family, and really getting experience from their perspective of life. And Kyiv was very generous. The money that was supposed to be set aside to defray my living expenses was given to this family because they were supporting me. And they essentially, you know, they got like the equivalent of 2 years salary from this infusion. So we're very, very grateful. Anyways, this is what I looked like back then. And this is at the famous Friendship Arch once in Kiev that has this statue that celebrates the union of Khmelnytsky's Ukraine with Russia in 1654. The great, you know, Druzhba Narodov, the friendship of peoples. This is what it looks like a little bit later. A crack was applied by protesters well before the war, incidentally, to show that the relationship between Kiev and Moscow was not nearly the way it once was. And the statue, of course, has now been removed since the attack. But Jews and Ukrainians were never free to really develop their relationship as communities with one another alone. There were always a third party in the room that affected how those relationships would be developed. So it was either, primarily, it was either the Poles or the Russians. One could say that the Germans also had a very large role in it in the 20th century. Just to quickly summarize, if this is new to you, don't worry, it'll just flow over. The most of Ukraine was under Polish rule until the 17th century when you had that major uprising. And at that time, Jews as a minority, and this is basically historically Jewish behavior, Jews will tend to culturally identify with the most powerful nationality in a given land. That's because as a minority, that's where their safety lies. So for example, in Quebec, Jews up until the Parti Québécois used to always identify with Anglophones because that was the real power in Montreal, Quebec City. But then after the Parti Québécois and those things, and that became very powerful, then many of the Anglophone Jews, like my family, my grandmother, Alain Chalm, she always used to spit on the ground whenever she said the name of René Lévesque. She would go, René Lévesque, and she'd spit. A lot of the Anglophones moved out of Quebec and moved to Ontario, and the Jews who remained, especially those who were attracted from French-speaking territories like Algeria and Morocco, they became Francophone and big supporters of the dominant power. You see the same thing happening in South Africa, where Jews tended to be more aligned with the apartheid forces until that fell, and that changed as well. So it's not surprising that Jews, even though they're living largely among Ukrainians, as a minority, they would identify with the Polish lords. And this was something that was prominent for much of Jewish culture. They never really developed a strong attachment to Ukrainians per se. They may have absorbed a lot of Ukrainian cultural information, but Ukrainians were not really, you know, creating great works of literature and things like that at that time. Eastern Ukraine was largely under Russian rule, and then with Catherine the Great's takeover of the Poland, then they all fall basically under Russian rule with a small segment explored so masterfully by Professor Himka under Austro-Hungarian rule. Now, this was a period of great change though, because both Ukrainians and Jews found themselves deeply alienated by Russian rule through the 19th century. And this can be seen in a couple of different ways. For example, the notorious Cantonist situation. In 1837, Tsar Nicholas I determined that the Jews were so difficult to assimilate that what he had to do was to forcibly conscript them into the Russian army at a higher level than ever before. Historically, Jews typically avoided serving in national armies, largely because they were inimical to Jewish practice. There's no kosher food. There's no Sabbath observance. You're taken away for a long period of time. So they typically paid a double tax in order to avoid military service and to exempt themselves financially. This is one of the harbingers of modernity is when Jews begin to actively participate in armies like in the United States of America, Canada, and so on. So what Nicholas I did was he said, okay, first of all, we're canceling the optional payment for Jews to exempt themselves from the army. Oh, I forgot one important detail. Army service in the Tsarist era was 25 years, was not a short thing. It was a career choice. It was often, you know, the perfect thing for the third son of a family. The first son would get the land, the second would become a priest, the third son would say, oh, I guess I got the army. So Jews would avoid this like the plague, but Nicholas I said, no, Jews have to participate in this as well. And he also realized that by the time Jews reached the age of 18, which was conscription, they were probably already too deeply influenced by their Jewish background to possibly assimilate successfully. So therefore, he lowered the age of conscription to 12. 12-year-old boys could legally be taken from the community, sent off to these military schools called cantons for 6 years, and then they would begin their 25-year sentence in the army, or as we used to call it, serving the Tsar's uncle. This is the reason why my grandfather, of blessed memory, fled Russian Lithuania in 1904, because he didn't want to fight the Japanese, despite the fact that it was, you know, the battlefront would be proximate to authentic Asian food. He said, no, I'm going to Northern Ontario. Sometimes that joke works, but I guess it's not. So there was a terrible situation. The Cantonist was one of the reasons why Jews began to actively hate Russian authorities. Much more to say about it, but that's all I can attack right now. Nevertheless, Jews enjoyed a phenomenal population boom in the 19th century. The advent of the smallpox vaccine had a lot to do with infant mortality. Also, the establishment of something called Kest, which was a situation in which multi-generation households would take care of small children, meant that Jews actually had a higher birth rate than surrounding populations in Ukraine. And from this page in Professor Magachi's map, Atlas of Ukraine, you can see the green colors indicate the concentration of Jews in various regions. The blue line indicates the boundaries of Ukraine. And you can see that Jews are more than 15% in many places. Furthermore, if you look at the specific types of settlements, Jews were highly concentrated in mid-sized villages. Berdichev, for example, had somewhere over 77% Jewish population. Khmelnik had 80% Jewish population. And the large cities tended to have about one third of their populations were Jewish, legally or not. Kiev was technically off limits to Jews, but it had about 60,000 Jews living there illegally anyways. So you've got a lot of Jews living in this territory. They're much more hostile to the Russians now. And Ukrainians are also going through their period of national awakening and finding that the Russians are blocking them at every turn as they attempt to develop their language, their culture, and so on. This is a period of great identity formation, not only for the Slavic peoples of the land, Ukrainians in particular, but also for Jews who essentially invent Zionism at this time. The idea of returning to the land of Israel is, of course, millennia old, but it was always associated with the arrival of the Messiah. In the late 19th century, Jews concentrated basically in southern Ukraine begin to experiment with the idea of creating a political state in the land of Israel that is exclusively Jewish, or at least primarily Jewish. So these national identities are forming at the same time in the same place in Ukraine. Okay, that brings us up to the 20th century. I think I should pause and take a drink and ask if there are any easy questions before we go into the hard stuff. Nobody likes to ask the first question. Oh, I'm good. You have a second question. Go ahead. And you, sir, afterward.
When did the part of Western Ukraine that was under Austro-Hungarian rule end up part of Ukraine?
Well, when we get to the 20th century, you see, no, that's fine. It will be fought back and forth, and there are actually several parties that will lay claim to it. But basically, after World War II, it's made part of the Ukrainian SSR. That would be like the region where Lviv is and things like that. Okay. Yes, sir, in the back.
Yeah, like with the Tsar Empire, there was that like a bomb, and then you said they found the scrolls, and then in there there was a thing written in Yiddish. That said, was it the translation that was at the bottom saying we
have
read or we?
Yes.
Yeah.
That the bottom, because basically the way these documents work is like someone will knock on your door and will say, you know, I've fallen on hard times. I had an operation. I couldn't work anymore. I have to marry off my daughter, and they have a whole list of things.
Right.
And at the bottom will be the signatures of rabbis or community leaders. Will say, yes, this is true. anyone who will help this person should receive a blessing and so on. So you know it's not a scam artist.
Oh, I see. So yeah. We have raised it's a signature.
From the authorities, from the...
Oh, yeah. I see. Oh, because
right. Typically they'll come, like from Israel, they'll come to New York City.
Oh.
And they'll travel around and they'll present these documents.
Oh, I see. Okay.
But it indicates that someone of authority in Kiev could not write in English and Hebrew, I'm sorry, and had to sign his name in runes. Like, that's really strange. But the whole Khazarian episode is really bizarre. Any last questions before we go on? Okay, so the 20th century is perhaps the most difficult. Anyways, I have a quick plug for my book because I study this specific area and that's rather tasteless. So I guess I'm going to just only plug the Ukrainian translation, which came out a little while ago. Oh my gosh, is this a Zoom audience or what? You guys are fire. So I spent a lot of time studying the period of the revolution. And in a nutshell, what basically happened, the Russian government collapsed in 1917, and there was a brief period of time when the remaining pieces of the Russian Empire sort of recalculated, like their GPS was recalculating how they're supposed to get through this. And the Ukrainians said, well, we want to have independence. They found, however, that they were hampered by the fact they had very few like government-ready people. People who are literate and numerate, people who are urbanized, people who knew how to organize things. This is overwhelmingly an agrarian society. They were great at farming, but they did not necessarily have the manpower and woman power to run a modern state. And they looked to allies in the urban sphere. Of course, Russians were not in favor of this because they considered Ukraine part of their historic Russia. The Poles also viewed Ukraine as part of their historic land and were not as enthusiastic about participating, although they did have success in recreating Poland, of course, after World War I. The only really significant national group living in the cities were the Jews. And the Jews, perhaps surprisingly, said yes. There's obviously a spectrum of opinion, there's left and right in the Jewish community, but they basically said, okay, this is worth trying, particularly if we do this in a moderate way and remain within the idea of a Russian Federation. They like the idea of like going step by step, but ultimately the Jews and Ukrainians worked out a deal. The deal, however, fell through miserably. Even though they had these remarkably utopian kind of thoughts, like we'll create a ministry of Jewish affairs, tax money will go to fund Jewish schools and synagogues and ritual baths, Yiddish as an official language of the state, all kinds of beautiful things like this. They were overwhelmed by the social upheaval that came at the tail end of 4 years of World War I and one national revolution in the spring of 1917, another revolution led by the communists in the fall of 1917, followed by a horrific civil war in which the communal violence vastly outdistanced anything that had ever happened before. The sheer scope of the violence of 1919 was so great that if it were not for the Holocaust occurring 20 years later, we would all be talking about 1919 all the time. It's only because the Holocaust represented still another, you know, huge algorithmic leap in violence that we basically forgotten about this horrific time, but it was truly phenomenal. The Ukrainian government tried to establish itself against the tectonic shifts that were happening, the multiple groups that were fighting on Ukrainian territory. But ultimately, as Professor Himka mentioned, they are essentially reduced to being a mobile government operating out of train cars in a little triangle in Western Ukraine, trying to evade the attack of Russian forces. Now, the great paradox of this period, which I explored in my research, was the fact that of the pogroms, of which we have quite a significant body of testimony, about 40% of those pogroms were actually perpetrated by the same government that was at the same time proclaiming all of these newfound rights for Jews. At the head of it was the man portrayed in this statue here, Simon Petliura, who was on the one hand trying to hold together this, you know, coalition of forces with no resource to do it. And at the same time, he's trying to promote what are essentially liberal Western values. Petliura himself is a very complex figure, and we've engaged in many debates about his specific orientation, but he becomes a flashpoint in the understanding of this period and a deflection point for Jewish-Ukrainian relations, as I will show you in a moment. Here's an image from the Times of Israel, a very popular Israeli newspaper. And as you can see, there's a statue erected to Simon Petliura, who, like Khmelnytsky, and to some degree like Bandera, is a Ukrainian hero, a national hero for asserting independence of Ukraine against all odds, and at the same time viewed by Jews as a pogromist, correctly or not. And you can see he's surrounded by blue and yellow flowers and so on. So for Ukrainians, it makes perfect sense. Yeah, of course, we're going to put Petliura here in Vinnytsia. It certainly makes sense. But for Jews, it's like within walking distance of a synagogue. How can you possibly be so offensive to place someone who created such violence against us in such close proximity to one of our holy places? The reason why Petliura himself is specifically such a flashpoint is because of the circumstances of his assassination at the hands of this man, Shalom Schwarzbard. It's a fascinating story that's worth exploring. Schwarzbard walked up to Petliura, who was living in exile in Paris in 1926. He said, "Vous êtes Monsieur Petliura?" He said, "Yes." He shot him dead. And then he simply stood there and was arrested. The Paris court tried him, and in a brilliant legal strategy, the defense argued that Schwarzbard was acting out of revenge for the pogroms that Petliura had perpetrated on the Jewish people. And amazingly, the court in Paris began to view the proceedings not as a tribunal to decide the fate of Schwarzbard, but really a tribunal on Petliura's guilt or not. And perhaps thinking in the background of the horrible debacle of the Dreyfus affair 30 years earlier, the Paris court ultimately acquitted Schwarzbard. They ordered him to pay a token amount of damages, one franc, to Schwarzbard's widow, and they set him free. And so for Jews who had mobilized, and by the way, the historical establishment was very much involved in this. Jewish historians were called in to defend Schwarzbard. Ukrainian historians mobilized to try and not to attack Schwarzbard, but to defend Petliura, because that's the way that the trial had gone. And when Schwarzbard was acquitted, it was viewed as kind of like the judgment of history, whatever history is. The judgment of history was that Petliura created those pogroms. He was the architect of the violence, which I think is a huge overreach. In my research, I believe it's more appropriate to think of Petliura as perhaps someone who was inclined to be silent regarding the pogroms at a key point in time during the spring of 1919, largely out of fear of alienating his erstwhile followers. He corrected that and began to speak against the pogroms later, but it was largely too late. So he definitely was not like the architect of the pogroms. He may have, though, committed a sin of omission, serious one, but definitely not the way that the historians of the 1920s portrayed it. But when Schwarzbard was acquitted, there was a massive roar in the Jewish community of excitement. This is a remarkable image painted by Chagall, the great painter, that shows the angel of vengeance, the mashkin that described in the book of Exodus, an image of gods acting in the world like the fast of the death of the firstborn, the 10th plague. The Torah scroll underneath it actually has the name Schwarzbard written on it, as if his name and his person is identical with the teachings of the Torah. A rather dramatic kind of image that illustrates the way many Jews spoke about him. A street among many was named after him in Beersheba, Israel, and it was called Rehov Hanokim, the street of the Avenger. And in brackets, in case you're wondering who the Avenger is, it says Shalom Schwarzbard. But this is the way that Jews began to form their thinking about their relationship to Ukrainians, largely in the wake of that Schwarzbard trial. Let me just see what I've got here. Then we move to the Holocaust itself. And maybe we should pause again for questions before we talk about this most difficult period. perfectly clear as the sun at noonday. Okay, very good then. The Holocaust. So it's very important to have a handle on the maps of this period. The Ukraine, you'll recall, is part of the Soviet Union at this point, and the western part of Ukraine is part of Poland. Hitler realizes that he cannot win a two-front war. He can't fight to the east and to the west simultaneously. Germany is in the center of the continent. He needs to pacify one side before he attacks the other. And then, of course, he has plans to go back and double-cross his erstwhile ally. So he and Stalin hammer out a non-aggression pact in 1939. They sign it, and that allows the Germans to focus on their Western front, conquering France and so on, knowing that their Eastern flank is protected because they have an agreement with the Soviets. That agreement is shown here in this map. You can see that Poland is cynically removed from the map. The Nazis take what is west of that yellow line, where they will begin to concentrate the Jews in a region called the Generalgouvernement for later massacres in the death chambers. And on the right side, in the sort of pale green, are the regions that are seized by the Soviet Union. And they belong to the Soviet Union between 1939 and 1941, and they go through a period of rapid and brutal communization, where the NKVD, the Soviet secret police, come in, arrest the intelligentsia, torture them, later massacre them, horrible forced confiscations of property, massacres left and right, explosions, blowing up of churches, all kinds of things like this. A very, very awful period of rapid communization, which, for reasons which are beyond what I want to talk about today, were associated primarily with Jews. Jews were believed to be heavily involved in this activity, although there does not seem to be a tremendous amount of support for that particular widespread belief. There were definitely Jews who were associated with the dreaded NKVD and their earlier incarnations, but they largely did not survive, especially not proportionally or disproportionately after the Stalinist purges of the 1930s. But be that as it may, the people living in these regions, which are called by the historian Timothy Snyder the Bloodlands, harbored a tremendous resentment against the Soviets, not only for their domination of territories to the east, but also for this 2 years of incredible struggle for them. Many Jews were able to flee, about 600,000 fled to the east, surviving in places like Siberia, Tajikistan, and so on. But these regions here were just ripe for much worse attacks. And that happened in 1941, June 22nd, when Hitler launched something called Operation Barbarossa, and a phenomenon which has been called the Holocaust by bullets. He sent in the Wehrmacht. He double-crossed Stalin after he had successfully appeased his Western Front. He double-crossed Stalin, and he crossed the border into the Soviet Union. And the Wehrmacht made tremendous rapid advances into the former Soviet Union, coming right up to the gates of Moscow and St. Petersburg, placing them under horrific sieges. But what's significant for our part of the story in particular is that behind the Wehrmacht, behind the regular army, he sent four mobile killing squads called Einsatzgruppen. And these Einsatzgruppen had the task of going into the small villages, rounding up, in particular, Jews, communists, homosexuals, Jehovah's Witnesses, anyone who represented themselves as an enemy in Hitler's bizarre vision of the world, bringing these people out to ravines or forcing them to dig their own graves, and then massacring them with machine guns. An estimated 1.5 to perhaps as many as 2.5 million people were killed in distant farmlands all throughout this region, including the 33,000 killed in Baban Yar at this time. My own family, those that did not join my grandfather when he fled Lithuania, also found their last resting places in an unmarked field outside the city of Kaunas. This is a marker that people put up afterwards to designate the spot where my own family lies. So this particular period is especially difficult for Jews because
the Nazis were able to rely on significant indigenous support for their attacks on the Soviet Union. The so-called Hilfswillige, or, you know, free willing or of free will for people of not only Ukrainian, but also Polish, Lithuanian, and Latvian and Estonian, were willing to join the Nazis and push back the Soviets. One of the most difficult units associated with this period, not Hilfswillige, but the Galicia Division, which represented a lot of Ukrainians in the western part of the territory, believed that joining with the Nazis was the best way to rid the entire territory of the Soviets. And they ended up signing up. And that made a huge difference later when they attempted to enter this country and the United States of America. And they actually were former SS members because it was a Waffen-SS division. They were ultimately cleared. The Deschene Commission, which caused a huge hoo-ha in this country, determined that they had not committed any war crimes. But this is the stain that the association with the Nazis held for many Ukrainians, Lithuanians, Latvians, and so on during the period. There were definitely isolated moments of great humanity, many of which have not been properly recognized, such as the incomparable Metropolitan Andrei Sheptytsky, who personally acted to save some 200 Jewish youth in his network of monasteries, very important churchmen in Western Ukraine. He was actually a great Philo-Semite. In 1903, I was privileged to come across this letter, not in 1903, not quite that old. I was privileged to come across this letter written in 1903 in Hebrew by Metropolitan Sheptytsky, a concrete reminder of his Philo-Semitism, which he demonstrated throughout his life. I think one of the most fascinating elements of this letter is, and proof that he is the author, is a very common spelling mistake. He transposed the silent letter Aleph with the silent letter Ayin in the common word if, which is a mistake that no one who had learned Hebrew from their youth would make, but someone who had learned as an adult may actually come across. So there are some bright lights in this story, but otherwise for Jews, it is inevitably dark. So that takes us through the vast majority of my presentation. I'd like to speak very briefly now about some thoughts on our current situation with the conflict in Ukraine, and then conclude with some implications for the future. So are there any difficult questions? Okay, let's go on then. Here's a picture of Vladimir Putin in 1980 when he was a KGB officer in Germany. And Putin is a slave to the idea that Ukraine belongs to Russia historically, that this is an idea that was very well developed in the 19th century, the notion that Ukrainians, the term Ukrainian, by the way, is a fairly new coinage, like maybe late 19th century. Ukrainians themselves were not entirely sure what to call themselves, particularly in Western regions, but the Russians would refer to them as little Russians, i.e. they're not quite the same of us. Their language is kind of quaint and sort of country-like, and maybe like someone from New York would listen to someone speaking from Arkansas, perhaps, and sort of smile while they heard the accent. But they would say they're our younger brothers, the smaller Russians, the little Russians, and so on. And the idea that they could rebel against the elder Russians and to separate themselves from this territory is unheard of. It's quite ironic because the origins of Slavic civilization really begins in Kiev. And Moscow only develops many hundreds of years later. When I gave a version of this lecture and was, perhaps unwise enough to actually post it on YouTube, I got so many hate hits and lots of Russian bots attacking me when I made this statement that in reality, Russia belongs to Kiev more than Kiev belongs to Russia, because Kiev is where these great Slavic societies emerged from. Russia was nowhere at the time when Kiev was already a principality. But Putin has the opposite idea, really a grand imperialist idea of the 19th century, this idea of Ruski Mir, the Russian world, Russian civilization, which must encompass Ukraine. The idea that Ukraine could betray Russia and walk away is something that is anathema. And the vocabulary that he used, which I believe he uses cynically and in a criminal fashion, but I also believe at the same time, he believes it.
is that the Ukrainians are Nazis. Now, what exactly does that weird word mean? I mean, everybody in the West is scratching their head and saying, what? We know the whole history. I've already described to you in very brief form what the association of some collaborators were and why they did it. But to call them Nazis just seems so bizarre. Like, you might as well call them, there, you know, it's a Martian invasion going on in Kyiv, and that's why they're attacking us. So we should understand that the term Nazi means something very different for Russians, for Jews, and for Ukrainians. For Russians, it's kind of like this massive statue that stands in Kyiv, holding back the German advance into Russia. And it's kind of laughable because, after all, Stalin first signed a deal with Hitler and believed that he was a valuable ally for him. But nevertheless, when Hitler double-crossed him, then all of a sudden Hitler becomes the horrible enemy and they begin to push him away. So Nazism for Russians represent that great imperialist threat from the West, which I believe Putin sort of allies with the word NATO in many ways. For Ukrainians, however, it's more complicated. For Jews, obviously, it means outright destruction. Nazis are the kryptonite to Jews, and there is no working with them whatsoever. But let's focus a little bit more on Ukrainians and its complexity. Here you see a poster that celebrates some of the insurgent movements created after the war. And you can see on the top here, there's the Varangian Viking roots of Kyiv on the left. And on the right, there's a typical Cossack again. So again, my heart begins to palpitate when I see that. It's Slava Ukraini at the top. And then at the bottom here, you see Heroyam Slava, but the Ukrainian patriot, who, by the way, is holding up his hand in a very Nazi-like salute, but I don't think that's the intention here. He's standing on the banners of the Soviet Union and the Third Reich. And the idea is, and the idea that I think Ukrainians would like to project from this period, is that of those who push back against imperialists from the East and from the West simultaneously, striking out in a very Khmelnytsky kind of mood to create their independence. That was not historically accurate. The Ukrainians saw the Nazis as a much better chance of getting the Soviets out than by doing it at their own, with the exception perhaps of one particular group. But this is the way in which they may like to phrase their understanding of the Nazis. And one of the problematic issues, especially early in the war, was the association of, with at least some elements of the Ukrainian military. And certainly we can debate to what degree this is valid, but the Azov division, which has a lot of symbols that definitely make Jews and Westerners uneasy, very fascistic kind of, you know, symbols that are highly evocative of these kinds of things. But I don't think we should waste a lot of sleep over this. The fact that there are possibly some far-right elements in the Ukrainian military, you know, if you wake up and smell the hummus, we have neo-Nazis everywhere, right? This is October in Los Angeles, and I could bring you newspaper articles from all over the United States that regularly demonstrate how many neo-Nazis there are on this continent. So I think it's blown way out of proportion and largely serves Putin's purposes when we talk about Nazism in that regard. But I'd like to take us to where we are right now with Volodymyr Zelensky. And one of the things that I think he's done for Ukraine is the fact that he has really cemented Ukraine's trajectory towards a more Eurotropic direction. That he has said, you know what, Ruski Mir simply does not work for us at all. We are all European Union types. We're all, NATO types. We value the liberal democratic values of the West over the autocratic values of the East. This is something that has been very popular with, of course, the allies in the West. And he's done a tremendous job as a communicator getting that across, particularly to the rest of the world. And ironically, Putin's invasion has only accelerated this trend, something which was always present in Ukrainian society, really even 19th century. But this is something that I think is now irrevocable, and that Ukraine will ultimately find itself, as long as it can survive this particular encounter with Russia, it will find itself within the European orbit more than ever before. Let me conclude with some statistics and a dramatic, I think, illustration of the point I'm trying to make here. This is a remarkable study that was done in 2015 by the very reputable Pew Research Center. This was well before the current conflict in Ukraine. And they wanted to ask Eastern Europeans, how would you feel about making Jews citizens in your countries? And when you look at the map here, you see a startling number. Ukraine has the lowest measurable level of anti-Semitism in 2015, as conducted by this very well-regarded research institute in the United States of America. Russia has about a 14% incidence of people saying you'd rather not have Jews part of our country. My homeland of Lithuania, almost one in four Lithuanians are glad my grandfather left. I am too. Romania, one in five, but Ukraine has a remarkably low number, 5%. It seems like a massive outlier, but it certainly speaks to the trend that we are discussing. And we can see it in so many of the things with Zelensky's tremendous love affair with the United States. Here is a photograph of him when he came to Congress most recently and delivered, I think, a very dramatic address there. And even Israel, which for a variety of very complicated reasons that particularly revolve around the threat of Iran and Russia's engagement with Iran. Israel obviously has a large population of Ukrainian Jewish refugees and Ukrainian refugees and Russian Jews as well, as tried to thread the needle between maintaining their own geopolitical position and yet the widespread sentiment in favor of Ukraine. Putin may have been poisoning the well, even in Israel, because of his closer and closer relationship with Iran as of late. But I think the most dramatic illustration of this shift in attitudes among Jews regarding Ukraine is illustrated by this article that came out just about a week and a half ago in the New York Times. It's a very sad article. By Jeffrey Gettleman, accompanied by photographs by Ivor Prickett. And it's about a young married couple named Taras and Ohla Mester, who decided to sign up. They were living like basic kind of yuppie lives, successful urban professionals, but they decided they wanted to fight on the front lines. They wanted to fight together. And they went to the front lines together and they were killed together tragically. You can see that there's a photograph of them taken from their home. And you can see that, you know, they look like the quintessential Ukrainians, dressed in traditional costume, young people, happy, smiling. And when I read this article, tears came to my eyes when I read this passage. Taras and Olha met when they were 8 years old, part of Kropivnitsky's tiny Jewish community, remnants of what was once a vibrant group massacred during World War II. They went to the same Jewish school. And it amazed me because these people, they don't look Jewish, they look Ukrainian. Their identity, and by the way, the whole article is worth reading. They have all kinds of Ukrainian iconography throughout their house, literal iconography, by the way. But it just, it's part of the thing. They're Jewish, and yet they stepped up and they felt they needed to identify themselves with Ukraine. This, I think, is the most tragic and poignant illustration of the development of a Ukrainian Jewish identity that we see is occurring in front of our eyes as this horrible, brutal war accelerates the process. We hope that that Ukraine finds peace and is able to reestablish itself, and that the Jews of Ukraine are able to reestablish their lives in peace and security. And with that, I want to thank you very much for your attention over the past hour.